We are live. So this is Chalice and Chains, and today I am very excited to be introducing my very first game of Numenera. This will be my first experience with it, but I'm super excited because I have what I would consider probably one of the best groups for my inaugural game of Numenera. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to kick it over to them, let them introduce themselves. I'll do a quick intro here, and then you know, we'll get started. So I'm going to start from my left. So Nelson, if you want to, do you want to start?
I mean, yeah, I'll usher in this group of fine role players. My name is Nelson. I run a YouTube channel, Facebook group, and other shit under Infinite Roleplay. You can go there and find cool stuff. Until then, peace.
Awesome. And so that's setting the tone for how the game's going to go. I'm super excited. And with that, I'll kick it over to Chris.
What's going on, y'all? Christopher Carosella here, man. I'm psyched to be playing this Numenera. I got this crazy little fucker I'm going to introduce to y'all. Let's get it in.
Nice. Thanks, man. Last but not least, Mr. Posey.
Hi, my name's Philip Posey. I run the channel Maps and Dragons. And I look forward to playing some Numenera tonight. Let's get it going.
Alrighty. So, you three are in the village of Codun, which lies near the center of the southern border of the Pytharon Empire. To the east of the town lies a racetrack, a half mile around, and it's here that the locals race these 14-foot biomechanical insects called rukomol. So you've spent some time in this town, you know, a few days, a few weeks, whatever, have gone to the races, and you've gotten to know one of the racers, a man named Uolis. Now, he's the most prestigious of the racers, and even invites you guys into his house to celebrate his victory dinner. During that evening, you guys are having a good time, maybe have imbibed a little bit too much, you know, alcohol, which in this part of the town is fairly rare, so you guys are having a great time when you notice this mysterious thick blue mist that rolls in and surrounds the town. Within that mist, as it starts to dissipate just a little bit, you notice that Uolis all of a sudden looks up and looks very nervous, and when you question him about it, he tells you, I can't hear my rook. I can't hear my rook. Help me, come with me. And so you guys all run out to the stable near his house, and you see that his rukomol are gone. The creatures that he raises, his living, his livelihood, are missing. He's in a bit of a panic. What is he going to do now? This is what he makes his living. How's he going? You know, and he lives a life of luxury. He does pretty well. So he's kind of looking around. You guys are looking around, and you notice the leg, kind of a missing leg of one of these rukomol, and you pick it up, and whoever picks it up, it starts to kind of almost like magnetically pull you south. And you guys think about it, and it's this pull, and this whole time, Uolis is panicking. He's panicking. He's saying, what am I going to do? And when he realizes what's happening, and he sees one of you holding this leg, he kind of puts it together, and he's like, "Oh, this maybe this is showing you the way to my missing rukomol." He's like, "Would you be willing to go track it down? You would be well compensated, of course, but you know I can't do it myself. I can't risk getting hurt." And so he looks to all of you, and he poses this question: "Would you be willing to head south and track down his rukomol for an undisclosed amount of pay?" And before you answer, you guys know that to the south lies the Methunis Desert. And the rumors are, especially around town, that this cold, rocky, windswept desert is a place of danger, but also of mystery. There are not a lot of stories that come out of the town, but or come into the town of the Methunis Desert, but those that do have definitely piqued your interest. So what do you guys say to his request to go find these and to be well compensated for it?
I draw up my knife. It's about 15 inches long, and on the side of it, it says Ford F-150. I run it down the side of my face real slow. I look at him and say, pointing it at him, punctuating each word, "I'll do this thing for you." And I slide it back into its sheath.
Nice. And as you do that, and this guy is remarkably short, and you actually realize that all of the racers are very short because they kind of have to be, right? To, you know, because there's two racers to one of these rukomol. So he's definitely intimidated by this, especially with this, you know, this blade in his face. And while he's a man that isn't normally intimidated, you know, he can hold his own. This is, you know, he's thrown, so he's certainly like, oh, but he quickly recovers. This. Thank you. I appreciate it. And he looks to the others.
Don't worry about it too much. How about you, fellas? How are you feeling?
Nuclear haven't been the one that picked up the leg of this rukomol. Looks down at it, and the mechanical side of his face lights up, and lights rotate on the side of it, and the eye lights up and looks down at the leg. And his other eye, the live one, looks at Uolis. Yes, yes. He chuckles to himself. I'll go. He looks up at the man with the sword that has S-150, wondering what the fuck it means.
Slowly nodding his head up and down, looking at the other two, and finally back at Uolis. Ken lowers his shades, and he goes, "Well, my friend, the journey of 1,000 shins starts with but a few steps." And then just grins as he raises his shades back up.
And Uolis kind of doesn't know what to make of this. He's somewhat put off, not put off, but sort of freaked out by this group of people that up until recently had been, you know, yeah, they'd been weird, but they'd all been having a good time. You know, he was the sort of the one in charge. He was the one kind of, you know, all you know, Billy Badass, so to speak. But now he needs a favor, and so now he's sort of like, oh. But he realizes that you guys are going to help him, so he's thankful for that. So he says to you, I know that this is going to be a long, hard journey, and I really appreciate you taking this on. When you return, with my rukomol or without, I assure you, you will be compensated. But, and he looks around, and the mist is starting to dissipate. It's still nighttime, and he's like, but it makes no sense to travel to the desert now. Why don't we come back inside, and you can leave in the morning?
The trail's hot.
And he kind of quirks his eyebrow a little bit, thinking, okay, wow, maybe this man, you know, is made of stronger stuff than I thought. And he says, well, I'm certainly not going to stop you. If you want to leave now, by all means.
I look at the other two, the one with the glasses, the one with the mechanical doodads buzzing over his face. I shrug.
Yes, yes, he looks at you, the mechanical eye looking you up and down, the light beaming over your body, then it cockeyes up into the stars, and his other eye gazes at you. I'll go tonight.
Seeing his brand new compatriots and bestest of friends, or only friends at the moment, Ken sort of just shrugs, starts rotating his arms to loosen up. Well, as you say, the trail is hot.
Well, you see Ogden, he rolls back on his heels real far, and then he rolls up on the tip of his toes and bounces back down. Then it's settled. Tell me, what is the name of your creature when we are to find it, this rukomol? What name does it respond to? What's the best way to urge it to leave with us? Is it stubborn?
And he looks at you and he says, well, in fact, it's more than one. There's probably about... Well, and he looks around and he realizes they're all gone. He's like, oh, there's four. Plus, it seems like there are at least three others from, you know, this is sort of a community stable. You know, some of the other racers are gone as well. So there's probably about seven all told. But he hands you this this little device, and he says, you know, and it's this little cylinder with this, like, little glowing, what looks to be kind of like a button on it. And he says, if you push this, when you're, you know, you're close in, they'll come to you for sure.
And you see Augie, leaning real close to him. You mean it'll make them stampede? Or they'll just meander on over like everything's perfect?
Well, to that, I can't speak. I don't know what state they're in, but normally they don't stampede.
And I know they're given to...
go ahead.
So they're probably kind of skittish animals. They're race animals.
He's like, well, you definitely have to have a strong hand with them, but they've never been too skittish around me. But I could imagine...
Hawkton makes his hand into a fist.
Nice. He's like, but I think you can handle them.
You're damn right.
And he kind of looks at you with a little more respect now, because, you know, these are the type of things where, because they're these biomechanical insects, you know, they do take a little bit of special handling to get them to do what you want, but he has helped, he's given you something that hopefully will help with that. So unless you guys kind of have anything else that, you know, any other pressing questions, you know, he recommends that you head out, but he does, he requests, you know, try not to get him injured if you can, and he looks to the, you know, to the leg that Nuclear is holding, and he says, at least any more than they have been.
Rubbing his chin and then looking over one shoulder, and then the next shoulder, rocking back and leaning forward again, smiling. Well, which one of those is yours? Your rook, friend.
He says, well, there were four of them that were mine. I don't give them names. I just take the one I need that I think is going to work best for that particular race. But, so that's really all I care about. I mean, they're not all that different. A rukomol's a rukomol, so you bring four back, that's great. If you can bring all seven, well, that's better.
Looking at his brand new compatriots. It's brand new and only bestest of friends. Again, starting to stretch. Oh, yeah, well, Knight's not getting any younger, is it?
I walk over to Uolis. I put my large, masculine hand on his shoulder. I shake him a little bit. I lean my head towards him. Don't worry about this. Don't worry at all. We got you. And I give him a good squeeze on the shoulder. I pat his face with my massive hand. We'll get him.
Nice. And as you do, yeah, he definitely winces a little bit. But surprisingly, those words are comforting him. He seems like all he cares about is getting these rukomol back, because, man, otherwise what's he going to do? Like, this is not the kind of guy that is made for labor or for war. So, he's grateful for that. And you actually, you realize that, you know, he's kind of, at this point, he's like sort of, he was all sort of tense before, and you could feel it when you kind of grabbed his shoulder, but now he's sort of relaxed a little bit, and he's like, Well, I suppose if you don't return... Well, I'll hire someone. I'll send someone out, but just be careful. There's creatures out there. There's raiders to the south.
You see Ogden crack his bull neck. Don't worry about it.
Nice.
Nuclear raises the leg up at him and shakes it. We will be very careful. And fluid like splashes all over Uolis. Throws it on his shoulder. Are you guys ready to go? I gotta talk like this the rest of the fucking game.
So I walk over and I face out towards the south, looking over at the blue mist, wavering, undulating, like some kind of slithering serpent that leads off into the distance. I start to make my way, the fog rolling around my calves like cold fingernails of the dead.
Damn nice. It. Come on, Gizmo Ford's leaving us.
He throws the leg in the pack and starts crawling away, almost ape-like, following along.
Yeah, and Nuclear, as you're holding the sort of the severed limb of the rukomol, it's just like almost propelling you forward south, you know, just deeper and deeper into the countryside at this point, because in Pytharon, it's grasslands and whatever. So at least for a while, this is a nice, kind of a safe journey. But you guys travel for probably about 14 hours before you hit the desert. And, maybe you will have stopped, you'll have rested, whatever, in between, but, that's about how long it takes on foot to get to the desert, to the beginning of the desert, and yet this thing leads you on. It's still pulling you south. And during this travel, you have time to sort of think back on what brought you here in the first place and how you became the people that you are today. And so what I'll do is I'll start, Phil, with you, if you don't mind, if you want to kind of go ahead and just sort of describe exactly that.
Sure. So you see Ogden, he's about 7 years old, and in his hand is the hand of a much older woman. She has long, flowing, dark hair, wide blue eyes, porcelain skin, and just these perfect teeth, and she's smiling down at Ogden. And they're walking along this road, and up above them is this huge crane, and a man who looks like Ogden when he's grown stares down at him, waving. Then the crane drops, and you see the man fall. Fall like he's an abyss, and the boy's eyes widen. As we zoom into the boy's eyes, an extreme close-up, you see the man fall into the darkness of his mind. Later that evening, you see Ogden, and he's sitting on his bed. His feet can't hit the floor, and he's swinging his feet backwards and forward. His hands dig into the mattress, and he's looking down. The door cracks open, and a ray of light hits him in the eye. He looks up. It's the dark-haired woman again. She comes, and she sits down by the bed. She kneels down and looks at him. She puts her hands on his face. Ogden, just remember, we're all here to feel good about our lives and about ourselves in general. So when you think sometimes you feel like things can be pointless, just remember, first and foremost, just try to feel good. And when she says, just try to feel good, you see Ogden the man standing over another man, just punching him in the face. Teeth shattering everywhere, falling like dice. Just do what makes you feel good, Ogden. And you see Ogden, he's in the corner of a rail house, and he has a long needle, and it's in his arm, and his eyes dilate. And the woman says, do what feels good to you. And he takes a knife and he's holding another man by the jaw, and he just slits his throat, and he watches the blood pour down the front of his chest into his piss-soaked lap. And honey, just collect those moments. And Ogden looks into her eyes, and for the first time that day smiles and says, I will. Now you see Ogden walking with his compatriots, a bag at his side, going backwards and forth. It's small, leather, soft, it smells sweet. But inside, you see the teeth of the man. You see the needle of the drug. And you see the peeled-off face of the other. Collect those moments, Ogden. Do what feels good to you.
Awesome. And as you kind of come back, you know, into the reality, and you start, at this point it's daytime, and you, the bright sun overhead is shining down, and you realize that you're cold. This is a desert that you're in now, but the desert is not one of those really hot deserts. It's much more arid, but you start to get into much more rocky terrain. And Nuclear, you start to feel this thing, this device, this thing start pulling you further and further and further, almost with more and, you know, more urgency. And you guys start to remember or think about the rumors that you guys heard while you were in town, the stories of this huge, massive pyramid that supposedly exists out in the desert, and how there was this man that went out there not too long ago, you know, maybe a few days ago. You can't remember his name. It started with a J. But they talked about this strange Numenera hunter that said that he was going to this pyramid to kind of figure out what was going on and to see what he could find. And of course they all think he's crazy, because, you know, these guys live a very simple life. They don't, you know, they like their racing, they like their tourism, right? They don't, you know, adventurers and treasure hunters, Numenera hunters, that's not something that they would be okay with. But so you start to think about this, and you start to realize, putting it together, Nuclear, that your, you know, your training and your kind of knowledge of the world around you and kind of how it works, you start thinking, well, this can't be normal. This has to be more than just coincidence that we're going to this same place. And what I want you guys to do is I want you to make an intellect roll for me. And it's going to be against a difficulty of 2, so a target of 6.
Seventeen.
Nice.
7.
7, all right.
10.
All right.
10.
So you guys all notice this. At first, you kind of hear something. You hear just this grunting and this.
What's that, guys?
Sorry. <Yep. laughs> No, it's all right. And it's coming from, you know, kind of ahead of you a little bit. You're surrounded by these sort of large, you know, some of it is sand, some of it's rocky embankments. So, you know, there's plenty of places to take cover, but you're almost kind of going through this path in a sense. And so you hear this grunting and this shuffling coming towards you.
So Ogden, walking ahead of everyone, puts his hand up, makes a fist, puts up 2 fingers, motioning for people to take cover. Something's ahead.
Ken is starting to rub his head and run his fingers through his hair. Very confused look on his face, and then turns to look at Nuclear.
His fingers go, Nuclear's eye follows him, and then he looks back at Ken, like, what the fuck does that mean? And he says it, what the fuck does that mean?
You'll see Ogden, and he goes and he shuffles behind a large piece of stone. Pokes out from behind. There's something up ahead of us. Something along the way. I don't trust the way it sounds.
Nuclear creeps and gets flat on the ground like a crouching spider.
Let's wait for it.
Yeah, Ken dips behind a rock as well, now knowing it was meant to hide. What was it?
You see, Ogden pulls out this 17-inch knife real slow. There's a pouch right next to him. And then inside of it, there's some kind of black liquid all spilling around, sloshing. He dips in the knife. The blade's coated black. It reflects his face. Don't worry, I'm going to go find out what it is. And he takes a step out, meandering, going in a wide circle ahead of the group.
Nice. And as that happens, you see this kind of dripping from the, as the liquid comes off the blade and it forms these words that says Super Duty on it. No, just kidding. So as you do that, and kind of everybody, the two companions are hiding, and Ogden, you kind of creep ahead, and all of a sudden, you see just a couple of creatures, and they have this, these horns, these goat-like horns, and these snouts, and some of them have booted feet. Others seem to have what look like hooves or something, and they're carrying, spears and just these kind of like mishmash weapons. Some of them are carrying pipes, just kind of anything that they might be able to find. Very, very simple desert clothing. They look like raiders, a raiding party. And you see about eight of them all kind of bunched together. One in the front who looks like it's supposed to be scouting but isn't doing a very good job. But because you were on the lookout, you can definitely act first.
You will see Ogden grab a piece of sand, and he's going to clench it real tight in his hand, and between his fingertips, the sand's going to pour. Life ends for all of us. And he's going to go as quick as he can and run back to his mates, because there's way too many people to fight.
Nice. And as he does that, you see this sort of tumbleweed come, in between his running form and the goat figures, and, they kind of notice you running back, but it looks like you're just by yourself, so they get excited, right? They're like, oh, yes, there's one, and you hear these grunts, pointing, and let's go, and they start rushing in. So if you guys want to, again, because you have, and granted, you're in this sort of narrow pass, so they can only maybe stand, two abreast, but you guys are certainly hidden, and they don't see you at this point. So Ogden, why don't you go ahead, since you ran back, you can tell me, if you're going to go and, try to hide, or if you're going to turn and face now that you're close to your companions. But what do you decide to do?
Yeah, I will turn and face them. I'll move behind a rock, and if the trail comes one way and you have to pass this rock to go through the trail, I'll wait for the first one to come by, and I'm going to stab my knife to the hilt of his face, crack open his skull down to the teeth, and rake out his guts, if I can.
Yeah, in fact, go ahead and make a roll. You can make your
knife. All right, sounds good.
Yep.
Oh, I have a knife, so it's going to drop the level by one.
Yep. So normally they'd be level two. In this case, it'll be level one. So you just need to roll a three.
And this knife is coated with poison.
Okay.
Okay.
Nice. And so
that's a 17. So all right. I think that gets us an extra point of damage.
It does.
This guy comes by. I crack him between the skull. You see his horns drop down to his shoulders.
Nice. And does the poison deal damage directly, or is it a different kind of effect?
It does. It does 6 points of damage plus the two from the knife.
Okay, yeah, so he's definitely dead.
I stand there, and I have my blade sheathed in his skull. His body just drops like a sack of shit, and I let all the other creatures see me slay him with one hit. I pull out the knife real slow. The brains just splash up in my face.
Nice. That's awesome.
Oh, thanks.
And he goes down, and his two the companion that was directly next to him, and then the ones behind him, you see that they get a little bit agitated at this point. They're like, you know, they're definitely angry, and so they start trying to rush in. They don't seem to be using any kind of tactics. They don't seem very smart. They're just, and they're kind of bottling up at this point. And so what I'm going to have you guys do, Nuclear and Ken, go ahead and just make a speed roll for me. For initiative, and if you can beat a so the target would be 9, so difficulty 3.
Yeah, I rolled an 11.
10.
All right. So Ken, you get to go ahead and act first, so you can tell me what you want to do.
So
you're Ken.
Yeah, so are they're already rushing in? They're already bottling up?
Yeah, they are, but there's really only, like, you could only face, like, two at a time. They can't get any more than that.
Seeing Ogden's performance, the show he made of slaying one of these things and the ease in which he did so, not to be outdone, you see Ken sort of just slowly stand up with his back facing these rushing creatures, and then in a quick motion he just turns his head to look over his shoulder, and in another quick motion he just rips his shades off and he goes, "Yeah," and then charges in.
Nice. Alright. And so, yeah, you could make a attack roll against the same difficulty 3.
Alright, now if I remember correctly, unarmed counts as a light weapon, right?
I believe so, yeah. Alright. So yeah, so then in that case it'd be a difficulty of 2.
Remind me, can I spend effort after the roll?
Nope.
So, I miss.
Okay. I'm assuming you did not roll a natural 1, right?
No, I didn't roll a 1.
Okay. So,
I see him trip over his feet. What a klutz!
Yep. Yeah, and he's actually standing right next to you, Ogden, because you guys, again, it's so narrow, you can only stand sort of 2 abreast.
So what he does, he turns around and he's trying to make a show of himself, much as Ogden did. And in all his efforts, he jumps up. He's preparing to do a flying kick, and he lost his balance slightly in the jump, and as he is shooting his foot outward to kick this creature, instead he only kicks the side of this narrow little area, hitting a tree or a rock, and then just spinning and tumbling and doing all he can to just not fall flat on his face.
Ogden, his head just shoots straight up, and he just starts barking laughter. God damn it,
Ken. Nice. And these goat figures start, they seem taken aback at this, not quite sure what to do, but they're emboldened by the fact that this guy just missed. And so, Nuclear, go ahead and let us know what you're going to do. Now, keep in mind that it will be difficult for you to get into any kind of melee or, you know, melee with these guys because you got these two guys standing in front of you.
All right, so seeing where my companions are, I'm still crouched on the ground like a spider. My robotic arm begins to tingle, and I jump up and I start galloping across the desert, the hard ground, and I look ape-like. Anybody seen a gorilla running through the forest? That's what I look like as I charge into battle. And I'll just move as close as I can because I know I can't attack. And as I'm running forward, I'm like,
nice. Awesome. And so you come right up behind Ken.
Can I kneel down and have him run off my back and jump into the air?
Sure, why not?
All right, I kneel down to one knee. Like I'm a football player, right? Like I'm getting ready to bash helmets. And I just make like this prop where you can run right off my back like a prop.
Nice.
Unleash nuclear!
Yeah. So if you want nuclear, you could definitely use that and try to, you know, sort of jump over him. There's a gap in between these first two and like, you know, the other five at this point. So you could potentially jump behind them if you wanted to. I would say you could make a speed test for me. And so in this case, I'll say, well, let's say it's a difficulty 3.
All right, I got 7.
Okay. Actually, no, you know what? Because he kind of got down to help you a little bit, I would say actually that would make it one step easier. So in that case, you'll actually succeed. So yeah, you do. You kind of jump over them. So go ahead and describe what it looks like. All
right, you hear a rush of air go out of Ogden.
Yeah. I see him crouch over. I jump up, my robotic arm digging into his back, my legs pushing off of his body, leaping up. I flip in the air as I somersault over top of him, and I land behind him animal-like, and I snarl.
Nice. That's awesome. And so as you do that, yeah, and you kind of, you know, hear the, you know, as all the air goes out of Ogden for just a minute. And who knows what, you know, what Ken's doing at that point, but you see these goat figures like kind of shocked for a minute. They almost don't know what to do. They didn't expect it, but quickly they regain their wits. And Nuclear, since you're the closest one, I'm going to go ahead. I need you to make a speed roll for me against a difficulty of 3 to avoid their attack. Unless you feel like you have any kind of assets or you want to spend any kind of effort to reduce the difficulty.
All right, I rolled a 1, natural 1.
Ooh, all right.
Fuck me up.
Ooh, what do I want to do? Okay, so, yeah, so they come in. The first one comes in dealing you 3 points of damage, so you can remove 3 from your might. But he also actually knocks you on the ground. So as he kind of whacks you with his spear, the force of it hits you and kind of bows you to the ground. And so your next turn, you're sort of like prone in a sense. And so what I'm going to say is that will increase by 1 step your defense rolls. So it'll make it harder. And actually the one that, so you leaped over them, so you're sort of facing, in a sense, 4 of them. And so in this case, the other one kind of comes up, the one that, you know, not the one that was sort of looking at Ogden, but the other group. And, yeah, and so you you can go ahead. Oh, yeah, Nelson just mentioned speed defense. So if you, yeah, so obviously you can roll speed for your defense, and if you have, you know, any kind of edge or anything like that, you know, obviously you have that, but they're going to attack you again. So again, Nuclear, make another roll for me. Yeah, you can use speed if you want, but it is increased 1 difficulty. So at this point, you'd have a 4. So a 12 target. Yeah, unless you want to spend some effort.
Oh, yeah. Dice stream's doing me good, except for that 1, 19.
19, all right, awesome. So,
right,
yeah.
So let me, hold on. As soon as I hit the ground from when it hits me, also, my eye was glowing this nasty green to intimidate him a little bit. but something happened to impact, and it's now cracked, and it's no longer working.
Oh, okay, wow. Nice, that sucks. Yeah, so you managed to, that happens, you managed to dodge out of the way, and it kind of unnerves these goat creatures a little bit, at least those two, but the two that are, that you've jumped sort of behind, they're looking at, you know, this guy who attacked them with no weapons and couldn't manage to hit them, and that emboldened them, so they're going to attack you. So, Ken, same thing, go ahead and roll. The normal target would be 9, but, you know, if you can reduce that, then you can reduce that. So.
Nah, it's cool. I just rolled an 11.
Okay, great. And so I'm going to say they both made that attack. They both miss. You managed. Go ahead and describe kind of how you dodged out of the way.
In the farce that was this flying kick, trying to capture, you know, his balance and tumbling around a bit, these creatures' attacks went flying, and more by accident than skill, he seems to just be narrowly evading every single blow by mere inches. And then when he stands up, he looks around, he's like, "Ooh!" And he starts jumping as if trying to look like he meant to do what he just did.
Nice. And you see the other ones kind of just pressing in, trying to get in, almost not, you know, not even caring that their companions, you know, are engaged in a fight. But they can't quite get to you guys, and they don't seem to have the wherewithal to, like, throw stuff at you. So, Ogden, what do you do now that you've seen all this take place?
Ogden takes his knife, dripping with ichor, and it's just like a pool of mud around his feet. The man's body that he's dropped has defecated all over the ground. He takes the blade, sheathes it, reaches back, pulls out a 3-foot-long greatsword. Yeah! He points it up. The tip eclipses the sun. Yeah! He puts it in both hands and just cleaves a man from shoulder to hip.
Awesome. And is it made out of chrome? He
does it.
Yeah.
That's a 2.
Oh. Nice. And I imagine that, you know, as this happens, and you know, this great sword that, you know, that maybe is, like, all cobbled together out of this, like, you know, shining metal, you kind of clang right on the ground right in front of them. And you know, they manage to, like, jump back a little bit out of the way, but, yeah, it's sort of like, and for a minute, you have to, like, strain to pull the blade out of the ground as it buried itself.
I'm pulling it. This is your warning!
Nice. So, Ken, you go ahead at this point.
Ken, definitely jumping out of the way of this blade that nearly hit him, starts hopping back and forth. He's like, all right. And starts unleashing a flurry of punches, jumping back forward in an attempt to just take out one of these creatures. And I believe a 4 does not do it.
No, it does not.
We're gonna get fucking killed. So he's unleashing these flurry of furious looking blows, this lightning attack, just rapid succession. Hitting nothing but air, simply because he misplaced his footing and didn't step forward enough after jumping out of the way of the sword.
Yeah, that great big sword. Nice. Awesome. And so, Nuclear, I imagine you would see this comedic scene playing out in front of you. You know, seeing the glaive, who should be the one just kicking ass and taking names here, not quite living up to it, and the ridiculous Nano with his, you know, his flurries here, just not performing. But you're only facing, really, for all intents and purposes, two of these creatures. So what do you want to do?
I want to punch one in the head.
Alrighty, go for it. And so again, standard difficulty is 3.
Fuck, man. All right, I'm not liking Dice Stream anymore. I got a 3. I rolled.
So. Nice. Yeah, I think it might be time to change to normal dice. So again, you punch him, and you know he just kind of blocks it almost with his huge arm.
So my robotic arm, I feel it tingling in my flesh. It now has fused together. It raises up. I let Luke just scream, ah! And I swing it forward. As I do, he just stops it. What the fuck?
Goddamn battery acid splashing everywhere.
I look over at Ogman and Cannon like, should we run?
What the fuck? What the fuck? All these nice. Goat men, they're like, meh, meh.
Yo. Nice. Yeah. And so, and with that, actually, Nuclear, go ahead and make a defense roll because, man, you're just not doing it today. But you can change dice if you want.
Oh, yeah. I'm going into my Batman bag.
There you go. Maybe the Dark Knight will give you some luck here.
Green arrow.
Oh, yeah.
You can also spend effort.
You can, yeah.
19.
Now, I don't know, does a 19 on a defense roll, that doesn't do anything, right? No. Okay.
No.
So, yeah, you definitely managed to get out of the way. They actually both kind of swing at you and go, you know, if you want, you can go ahead and kind of describe what it looks like, but they do
both
not.
Both of them are attacking me?
Yeah, and they both miss.
So either any punch, one of them swings at me, my feet leap in the air over top of his fist. I land down, the other fist comes at me, and I lay back over top of it, Matrix style, and I raise up, my fist still being held by this one's hand.
Nice. Yeah, and so you kind of see these these creatures, and now all of a sudden you see the ones kind of in the back get the wherewithal to, like, they lean down and they've, like, picked up these stones and they're just going to try to start chucking them. But it takes them a little while to figure out, like, okay, we got to throw them over our companions' heads. So in the meantime, you're going to see the two engaged with Ken and Ogden. They're going to attack. So, Ken, you go ahead and make your defense roll first for me. But these guys are attacking you with their pipes and their spears and all that.
Only got a 5.
Wow. So anybody who might
shortest game of Numenera ever.
Yeah, this is where you use ciphers or you use effort. But yes, so you manage to oh my god, you take 3 points of damage as it slashes into you.
So as he's unleashing this flurry that's just contacting nothing but air, seeing at the very last moment this spear, this makeshift weapon being thrust at him, he can do nothing to dodge out of the way and instead just clenches up every muscle he has in his body. Every tiny little muscle begins rippling and hardening almost as hard as stone, and as this pike hits him, it sort of just skims off his form, doing nothing but messing his clothing.
Ah, yes, that's right, because you have armor, sort of. Cool. Alrighty, and Ogden, if you can go ahead, the other one is attacking you with this big pipe.
Oh, you think you got something, fucker? I spit in his eye as he approaches.
Nice.
I roll a 4.
Oh, man. And you spit in his eye, and what ends up happening is he kind of, like, it enrages him to the point where, like, he just double hands this thing and just right down on your head. So normally he would deal 3 points to you. I don't know if you have any armor or not, but
I do.
Okay. Yeah. Yep. So you guys are looking at this scene, and you've taken a little bit, you know, damage here. And you kind of realize that at this point, the guys, you know, the other ones kind of that are stuck back in the canyon, they've picked up rocks, so they're getting ready. But with that, Ogden, you go ahead and decide, what are you going to do at this point?
Ogden, his eyes unfocus. Like, he sees double of everything in front of him. Like, oh, fuck, oh, you think you got something, huh? He reaches down to his wrist. On his wrist, he has this metal band. He starts to unscrew it. He takes it off with his hand. Oh, you want to throw stuff, do you? How many guys are behind him?
So you have, all right, so the two that are engaged with you, the two are engaged with Chris, and then there's three that were stuck.
So you see Ogden, like he's shooting a basketball, throws this cipher.
Awesome.
This
is going to be my 8th level detonator.
As he's doing that, being a nano, being trained in Numenera, seeing what's going down, Ken slowly removes his shades, and as he's doing it, his eyes are just widening in fear.
Now, nice. Now, the one thing I would say, Ogden, you don't necessarily know what this device does. So if you can, go ahead and make that intellect roll for me to see if you can make this thing actually work the way you want it to. Being that it's a difficulty 8, you're probably going to want to use some some effort here.
I will expend... this will come out of my intellect pool, right?
It will, yeah. Now, do you... except that... All right, because... that would still only reduce it one step, right? Which would still put it at a 21 target number.
That's right.
So, do you think you have any assets that might help you in this case?
Yeah, I look over to Ken. I'm like, you know what the fuck this shit is? So I'm going to throw it.
To Ken?
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Wait, you threw it to me?
Yeah. So why not, in this case, Ken, you go ahead. If you want to catch it, go ahead and make an intellect roll to see if you can figure out how to activate it.
Can I? Oh, God.
And are you trained in Numenera?
I am trained in Numenera, all right. Yes.
So that'll immediately reduce it to 7 difficulty, and then
you're still going to want to.
Yeah, so you're probably going to want to spend some effort.
Yeah, I'll spend some effort.
Nice. Just mark. Do you have an edge in intellect?
Yeah, I have an intellect edge. So I only got 2 points.
So you only spend 2, yeah.
So I need a 17 on the D20. Thank you very much, Ogden. You are such a friend. I am glad I decided to visit and play with you. Nope. I don't know what the hell it is. I got a 6.
Nice. All right. So, what do you want to do with it at this point?
Ogden, do you know what the fuck it is or not?
I'm just looking at it. I'm like, it's yours! I toss it back.
Nice. That's insane. So, right, ladies and gentlemen, this is what happens when you're a first tier and you have a level 8 cipher. It's like, oh my god! Nice. All right. So because I feel bad, I'm going to, Ogden, I'm going to let you still take an action.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah. Yep.
So what Ogden's going to do is he's going to take his sword that he has, and he's going to put it sideways. And the two people that are in front of him, he's going to try to push them down the ground.
All right, nice. So because you're trying to do it to two of them, I'm going to say that the difficulty is increased 1. So you're going to have, it's a 4 difficulty, so 12 target.
Okay. 20.
Oh, excellent. All right. So, do you want to damage them, or do you want to introduce some kind of major effect with that? Was that a, yeah, that was a natural 20, right?
That's a natural 20, yeah.
Yeah.
What I would like, can it be possible that the cipher goes off?
Yeah, I think so. I think that works. Damn. All right. Awesome. And so that's going to deal 8 damage to each of them then. That's excellent. Yeah, so that kills them. They both die in this bloody heap as I imagine almost like the cipher that was in your hand kind of tumbles out by accident and you it got activated.
Yeah, like it falls out of my hand, one of them steps on me, and it's just like an IED in Iraq.
Nice.
I see their bodies just fucking shred in front of me, like they've been touched by the hand of God.
Yep, nice. And as that happens, and this just detonation, this explosion goes off in this little sort of mini canyon, it for a minute it deafens everybody, and then the other raiders are like, oh my God, we're dealing with this kind of stuff now, and they book it. They start leaving. Because they're like, no way, we can't handle this. But you guys can each, if you want, take a sort of a parting shot or whatever, if you feel like it.
I'm close.
So Ogden stands there, hand on hips, while spit drips from his lips. That's all he does.
Nice.
Yeah, I want to take a seeing them start to run, I reach into my pack, my mechanical arm, and I pull out this tube, and I look down at it with my broken eye, and I'm like, fuck, I'm blind! And I look at it with my other eye, and it says, KY jelly, 24 ounces, and this is my cipher. And I aim it at him, and it says, for friction, bitches. And I squirt it at them as they run away, chasing behind them to make them, squirting it all over them.
All right, nice. Yeah, so that's fine. So what I'm going to make you do, though, because it does have a level, what was the level on that one? Do you remember?
A D6.
All right, just go ahead and roll the D6 for me and tell me what you get.
I rolled a 6. What does that mean?
Okay, so that means that this is weird, though, with this. You know what? Fuck it. I'm not going to make you roll because it's clearly liquid. You throw it at him. It seems dumb to to have to roll a 6 to figure out what lubrication is. So, yeah. So you go ahead and throw it, and they start slipping everywhere. Wah! You know, and their weapons go flying up in the air, and they all fall on their backs, and you know, the whole ground is coated with this, you know, this slippery substance. And they're, you know, they're trying to get up, and they're scrabbling, and they can't, and they fall back down. And so, Ken,
at this moment, Ken is just taking the time to wipe the giblets and gore and pieces of beast man off of his face and his clothing a little bit after what Ogden just did.
There's like follicles of hair falling down.
Nice. He's just staring at Ogden. Shaking his head.
Nice.
He tossed that to me.
What? What?
Awesome. And then they all manage to sort of, a little more slowly, get up and kind of quickly, assuming you guys let them go, kind of quickly back their way out. They're clearly not going to mess with you anymore.
Okay, good.
Nice.
I'm standing there.
I think
I kind of kneel down. My head's just like dripping blood. Oh, I got a massive headache.
Nice. And
it's a pipe to the head, guys.
Yeah, pipe to the head, exactly. That's pretty nasty. So. Yeah, so combat is over. You guys managed to survive against these raiders. You know, thank God that cipher went off when it did. You know, because clearly this fight was not going your way. And at this point, Nuclear, you now kind of again, you have this thing, you know, this device in your either in your hand or in your pack or whatever that's just pulling you south, like we get, you know, trying to lead you in this direction. And go ahead and if you can, go ahead and describe for me kind of how you became a nano and sort of what brought you here.
All right, so is this, I pulled this leg back out of my pack and looked towards it with this broken eye, and I'm like, fuck. And I look towards it with my other eye, and I put it up to my arm, and it puts me back in this daydream. I'm in this old warehouse on a conveyor belt. There's a line of robots. I'm digging using a screwdriver, taking parts, stealing it. It's within a blink of an eye, the whole place lights up. The conveyor belt starts moving, clamps grab my body. I'm moving forward. I watch as arms come in and rip parts off of old robots and put on new parts. I try to break free from it, and I can't. I'm next in line. I feel it clamp my arm. It twists it back, rips it off. I scream out in pain. It echoes throughout the old warehouse. The new one sticks on. It ignites with my flesh. I move forward a little bit. I see them hands reaching down, putting faces on. It's my turn. This machine comes down, squirts this adhesive onto the mask. It comes in, it smacks against my face. I feel this almost acidic-like singe as it's melting my flesh onto it, and I snap back.
It keeps pulling me south.
Nice. Yeah, and so as you guys continue to travel, you face no more opposition. In fact, you guys are aware that these raiders are sort of off on the periphery, but they don't seem to be, they don't want to engage with you at all. They're kind of, you know, searching the area, looking for whatever they can find, but they're not going to mess with you guys.
I go over to the back of Ken. I put my large, masculine, veiny hands on his shoulders. I start rubbing him. You were really great in that battle. You really showed them what was what. And I pat his back.
Hey, this is a face Nuclear's making.
That indeed just happens to be the same exact face Ken is making.
Nice.
There was the one that I stabbed in the head with the knife. His brain's full of poison. I cut off one of his horns and put it into that soft yellow pouch. Collect those moments, I hear my mother's voice say.
Excellent. So you guys travel on, and you actually you continue to travel. Night falls, and you're able to make camp. You're also able to, at this point, roll a d6 if you've taken any, any damage, and you can roll a d6 and restore whatever on the dice plus one for your level.
So you see Arg. He walks over to a rock. It's about 20 feet tall. His legs are about shoulder width apart. You hear zip. Three.
Nice. Plus the one for...
Oh, that's right.
Yeah.
I'm back up.
Yep.
Cool.
Awesome. And
how do you guys feel?
Still sitting down, relaxing, and still picking sort of creature matter out of his hair and flicking it away. Damn it, Ford. I rolled a 2 plus 1 is 3, but I only took 2 damage, so...
Nice. Okay. And how about you, Nuclear? Did you take any damage?
Yes, I did. I took 3, and I rolled a 4.
Awesome. So, yeah, you guys were able to regain your effort.
Yeah, as I'm sitting there kind of healing during this downtime, I look towards my arm, and it snaps me back into this daydream. And I'm back in the warehouse on the floor after getting off the conveyor about how I lived. I don't know. I'm only like 14, 15 years old, I look to my side, and my small body has this huge robotic arm on it. And I'm like, what the fuck is this? What am I gonna do? And it raises up in the air as a foreign cue and flexes a muscle. And I snap back out of it.
Og walks over to where the fire's being kept. It's raging like spirits are leaping up into heaven. He takes off one of his boots. Clunk. He peels off his sock. Puts his toe in his mouth and starts biting his nail.
Nuclear has the same face that he had when he rubbed his shoulder.
And you guys all share this special moment, and
it is.
And you Ken set just off, screams out, "Damn it, Ford!"
Yeah, right. And you set off the next day, refreshed, ready to go. And you travel through most of the day, and as you do, you kind of come out of all this rocky terrain into this flat plateau, and what dominates your vision is what you would see on my screen, this big black pyramid. But what you notice about it is that it is hovering about 80 feet off the ground, and underneath it is a city. The city, though, is in ruin. You can see kind of just barely at this distance, you know, the buildings are crumbling, and it doesn't look like there's any kind of movement in the city. You don't see any roads or anything going in or out. But clearly at one point this had been a fairly major, you know, sort of settlement civilization. And as you look around you, you notice like one set of, it actually looks like it might have been three people walking in, you know, towards the pyramid. You don't see tracks coming back out. So what do you guys want to do?
So Og, he looks down at his poison. Black. He looks at the pyramid. Black. He looks in his heart. Black. He sees all these trails walking to the pyramid, none of them coming back. Well, this could be it. Sure, those animals must be in there. He stops. The wind blows by him. The sand's just twirling around. Shh. What do you boys think?
The sand hits me in my face. I raise my hand up to block it.
I think I need to fix my eye.
I let loose this sad chuckle, and I look towards this black pyramid.
Maybe there's parts in there for me to find.
For sure. I looked inside your cracked eye, and I see two images of myself.
Do I look okay?
I've never seen you look okay a day in your life. So yeah, no. You're okay.
Spitting out this sand that is apparently whipping up everywhere, catching some in his mouth, trying to clear it out. Look, all I know is that this dude better make this worth it.
Absolutely.
And Ken, at this point, you know, being that, you know, you've come here for whatever reason, why don't you go ahead and tell us how you became who you were and why you came on this journey in the first place?
Well, you would see a dark and smoky scene. People giggling and laughing all over the place, music playing in the background. You would see Ken, much as you see him now, wearing his oversized shades, relaxing on a couch surrounded by women. He's laying there shirtless, just flexing his tiny but rippling muscles all over the place, just showing off, grinning and smiling, and they're just massaging him all over the place. Oh, Ken, you know, tell us how you got this body, and then fawning over Ken, and Ken is just like, well, you know, and the flashback leads into another flashback of Ken, and a dirty, old temple. You hear people screaming every once in a while, ah! Ah! And Ken sweeping the dirt from the corner, looking over his shoulder. No shades. Just malcontent on his face. After that night of sweeping and watching everyone train, Ken sneaks into his master's domicile, is searching around through the robes, sees a piece of old tech, a Numenera, smiles, reaches around to the back of his head. He happens to have a port near to the base of his skull. He slides this piece of Numenera into the base of his skull. As everything is blackening, you see Ken punching, surrounded by darkness, screaming, "Yah! Yah!" Fades back into the smoky scene with all the women pawing over Ken, big grin on his face. Lowers his shade, goes, "Well, honey, I could tell you." But, and you would see Ken back in the arid desert with his two brand new and only friends, whom he intimately calls Ford and Gizmo, looking at this giant hovering pyramid over this large, decrepit city. Shades in his hand, wondering, I hope that thing doesn't come falling down on us.
Nice. And as that happens, you almost, you don't hear it in real life, but you almost hear it in your head, like this silly kind of disco beat, and then you hear it like, it's Ken. You know, and then you kind of look and you kind of enter the city and you realize that there's this what used to be a wall around this city, you know, made of stone, and you can see these two pillars, kind of they look like towers in the middle of the city that reach probably halfway up from the ground to the base of this pyramid. They're about 40 feet up in the air. They seem to be mostly intact, but everything in this town is sort of falling down and you know, in a state of decay. And so, you know, you kind of approach a little bit slowly, a little bit hesitantly, and you find this entrance into the city. And as you're kind of looking around, you see the sand, you know, in the streets, and you look from one building to the next. You know, you see these just signs of what looks like it would have been built by this same civilization, but this was a much more primitive city. And everything is in shadow. It's all dark. There's enough light for you to kind of make your way through the city without any kind of light source, but everything is dark, and it feels colder than it did before because this huge shadow, you know, is over everything. And as you're kind of walking along, you know, just kind of searching the city, searching for, you know, for what to do, Nuclear, you're... The thing that you're holding, that you know, the oh man, the limb from this, you know, this rukomol kind of like shoots up, you know, like your hands go up as you're trying to hold it, and it's quite clear at this point that it's, you know, it's trying to show they're in this pyramid, and you look up at this thing, and I would imagine all you can think of is, what am I gonna do? Yeah.
What are we gonna do?
There's all this rubble. Why don't we just build an 80-foot staircase and walk up to this pyramid?
Yes, do that. That's a great idea.
I look at the pyramid, the base, the bottom of the pyramid. Does it have any graffiti on it?
Any no. Symbols, any writing? Well, yeah, there would definitely be there would be symbols. They look like kind of writing. It looks like basically writing from sort of the last generation, but not necessarily the last, not the last world per se. This would still be your, you know, ninth world settlement, but it's definitely a writing that you don't necessarily understand. There is stuff scrawled on the walls nearby. It looks like somewhat recently. And actually, as you notice that and that sort of kicks in, you actually hear just the faintest sound behind you, almost like these footsteps, and you hear this little giggle. And for a minute, you might think it's Ken being crazy, but yeah.
I spin around on my heels. I draw out my blade.
As Ogden does this, Ken turns around to look at Gizmo, put two fingers up, and goes, and then dives into cover.
Nice.
Gizmo's like, fuck!
I'm standing there, sword drawn, the blade out before me, splitting my form in two. What do I see?
You see this old woman just kind of shambling in. She sees you, but she almost doesn't take in the danger that, you know, that your sword, because she's too busy gnawing on, and you kind of look at it, it's meat, and it's cooked, but she's holding on to something. She doesn't have a utensil, and you realize she's holding on to a tail. So you realize she's chewing on this cooked rat, and she's muttering between the chewing, you know, and just this, they're here, they're good. They're gonna find everything. Yeah, maybe they'll take me away. What? And then she looks up at you, and she, you know, and you see on her belt, she's got this like this device that looks like it would, you know, kind of fire stuff at her. But she's clearly not looking like she's dangerous. And she looks up at you, and she kind of just peers at you with this weird grin, and she says, "What? My name is Lyra. Who are you?"
I put the sword into the ground, and it looks like a huge crucifix. My name is Og. Who are you, old crone?
And she looks very confused. She said, I'm Lyra. What? Why is he talking to me? What?
So Ogden takes out his hand wide, spreads it around the area. Where are we? What is this place? Who built this pyramid? What do you know?
And she lets out this weird little cackle, and she's like, clearly this was built by the gods. Don't you know? The city in shadow, this is where I live. This is where I call my home. Those other men, though, they're not from here. They don't belong here. The mist, they caused it.
They caused the mist. When the mist came, a lot of this racer, his herd got taken. These large insects, they're called rukomols. They're huge biomechanical insects. Did you see those men with those creatures?
And her eyes are kind of going in and out of focus. She's trying to sort of, like, you can tell she's trying to figure out what you're saying, and she wants to help you, but she's very confused, and she's just shaking her head. She says, no, I saw no creatures. Those men, they went up into the pyramid 2 days ago, well before the mist came. I didn't see any biomechanical creatures. No. She's like,
You'll see, Og will take one thick finger, place it under her frail chin, and she just has like these folds of fat and skin that like hang off her jowls, and he'll just bring her head up. How do they enter the pyramid?
She says, and she just kind of points to one of the towers, one of those 40-foot towers. She says, I don't know how they got up there, but she said, maybe this will help. And she starts reaching into her bag, and she pulls out this little cylinder. She has this, like, this, yeah, just this tiny little cylinder. It's got this button on it, similar to what you used before, but this is not, you know, this thing, you don't get the impression that this is a weapon. And what you see is it's actually this ball that's got this little, like, revolving thing kind of going around the side of it. It's weird. It's got all these strange markings and etchings on it. and she holds it kind of reverently, and she says, I found this on, and then she kind of points over to the side, one of those that are no longer alive, and they were treasure hunters too. They were going to go into the pyramid, but they were unsuccessful. Maybe this will help you, and she holds it out to you.
Og takes in his hand. He holds it real tight.
As she points off to the side, Nuclear looks down the street. He looks and sees a man sitting Indian style. He has a flute in his hand, and he's playing a tune. Wind whips through. Sand blows against everybody, and a snake starts slithering out. Out of this brown cask, he looks up at the pyramid.
Ah. Og takes this little ball, and he's throwing it like a Harlem Globetrotter. He walks over to Ken. Rolls it into the back of his hand, rolls it up front like he's David Bowie in Labyrinth, spins it on his fingers. Do you know what this does?
Are you going to throw it at him?
Ignoring Ogden, Ken is looking around the corner down the street.
Hey, Ken! Ken! Hey, Ken!
What?
Ken!
What? I'm trying to figure out what
Ken, do you know what this does? Bow,
noticing that he has another odd device in his hand. Once again, at this time, Ken's eyes widen open. You can see his eyebrows raising from behind his shades. And then he just dives further away from Ogden, screaming, "Not again!"
And yeah, Ogden just lets it spin and rest in his hand. All right, then. He puts it in his pouch.
Nice. And the old woman, this crazy lady, Lyra, is now looking at Nuclear as he may not have realized it, but that tune that he's hearing, he's actually humming it. And so her noticing this kindred spirit, this, you know, someone just as insane as she is, she's just fascinated by him, and she kind of comes over to him and starts actually kind of trying to rub up against him and kind of, how you doing? You know, that kind of thing. Totally nuts.
Nuclear has this look on his face. Ah! I got this servant, and he pulls out this thing, and he presses a button, and he lays it on the ground, and it starts glowing, and it starts transforming into a little chick, and she's a little figure, and she looks hot. I'm cool. And he presses a button on her butt, and it transforms back, and he puts it back in his pocket.
And the display of your Numenera there, or it impresses her that much more. She senses that you might be the person that could take her from this weird life that she's living, but she pays it no mind. Ken, you actually get the sense with your Numenera training that that the device that Og was holding does not seem to be a weapon. It doesn't seem to be something that would, you know, that could kill a couple of creatures accidentally.
Getting back up and dusting himself off, keeping his distance for a few moments and staring at the little pouch in which he stored this Numenera away and noticing that he is indeed in one solid form, the same form he started with, and not dozens of tiny little bits that gets sprayed all over you and stuck in your hair and just rot and stink in the sun. Just pick them out all night long and just the visions. And then regaining his composure once again. Ford, do you mind if I'll take a look at that. And he's pointing at his pouch.
All right, so Ogden walks over to you real slow. He takes the pouch off his hip. He says, "Oh, you want to look inside my bag?" He opens it up. The first thing you see is a severed human face. In its mouth, in its mouth, you see the ball. Why don't you reach in and grab it?
Oh, you know, she didn't give it to you, so just, and he starts just rubbing his fingers through his hair. I'm just gonna, and he just starts walking off in some random direction.
Nuclear looks at the snake. The tune's still playing in the background. He looks at this woman in front of him and realizes maybe she is beneficial to their what they want to get. And he reaches down and he kind of rubs her gently on the butt. And he says, "You are," in his sexy voice, "You are. You, could you help us any?" And he kind of pinches her ass.
And she's like, I could help you, I reckon. How, I got a hut over here. What kind of help are you thinking?"
"Well, my services aren't free. Maybe a cipher or something. Oddity, something, a Numenera from the lands. Maybe a little bit of information on the pyramid that you've been hiding."
And she looks, she's got this disappointed look on her face because, like, this woman literally has nothing. She eats rats, and she just gave away the one most valuable thing she had. And now she's the one thing that she was hoping to get. Seems like she's not going to get it because she doesn't have anything left to give. So she starts to cry a little bit. And she's like, I don't know. I don't have anything. I just gave it to that guy."
I don't think she's gonna be able to help, guys. Stay around now.
Ogden pulls out a metal container. It's full of water. He starts drinking.
And it's weird because it just parts. Automatically refills. It's like magic. And she's impressed, and she actually sees that and sees it refill, and she's like, "Oh, what? Do you have another one of those? Can I get one of those?"
"The only thing you're going to get is a fresh one. Get out of here, you old crone."
And for a minute, she looks intrigued and like she might take you up on the offer, but then she does. She shambles away, realizing that there's nothing left here for her.
So Og takes the vessel that he's drinking out of, points it towards the tower that the old woman showed him that the men entered. "Well, the men created the fog, I've been told, by this old crazy woman who went into this tower and entered into the pyramid. And it looks like we're going to have to go the same way if we want to get inside. God damn, Uolis!" And he takes his fist and shakes it at the base of the pyramid. "You and his goddamn rukomols are gonna be the death of me."
Nice.
And he starts walking towards one of the towers.
Yep. Awesome.
Rukomol, he did say that whether we return with or without them, right? I mean, we don't need to go inside the... And speaking to himself, trying to get some confirmation that that his thoughts are the correct ones to have, he turns to one of his brand new and bestest and only friends, one whom he lovingly calls Gearhead, turns to him and says, "Oh God." So just rubbing his head and just following Ogden.
Nice. And so, yeah, so you kind of realize that, all right, you got to get up into this pyramid, and It's 80 feet above you. You can clear half the distance by going up this this 40-foot tower. So, you know, so you do. And, you know, it's this kind of stone and metal stairway spirals up. You know, this looks like this may have been some kind of wealthy residence at one point, although almost everything in it is broken and decayed, you know, sort of broken down. And as you ascend the staircase, you get to the top, and it's almost like you would go to the roof, but you're like one level down, but it's all open up to the sky, and you can see the pyramid above you, and you can see this just sort of rippling, almost like that fog, or not that fog, what's the sort of rippling you'd see on like a really, really hot day. And, you know, you can tell that this is some sort of Numenera device. This whole thing is being suspended by some kind of, you know, power. And you can actually feel this energy, this you know, you can feel it. And you actually look to your side, and you see this sort of broken down automaton. It looks like it may have been some kind of, I don't know, cleaning device, something that would go through a city and kind of, you know, pick up rubble and trash and whatever. It's got these, you know, these large arms. One that has like a almost like a bucket loader on it, and it's got this like what used to be sort of this big kind of pail on the back, and you know, and it's totally broken down. You can see that it had tracked wheels at one point, but one of them is intact, one is not, and you just sort of are staring up. And Og, the device that's in your pack starts to kind of, you can feel it vibrating. Like the thing on the side is just spinning really fast now, going around it.
I take it out on my back. It's vibrating like a Nokia. I walk over to the automaton. Does it look like this device might fit inside of the automaton somewhere? I start to inspect.
Yeah, go ahead and make a intellect roll for me.
Not my best roll, guys. Here we go.
You never know. I'm going to say it's a difficulty... difficulty 3.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
10.
You make it. All right. So you actually manage to... You sort of figure out that, okay, this... You're kind of trying to figure out, all right, can this device fit into this... creature somehow, and you're looking, and you're, or not creature, this automaton, you're looking, and you notice this sort of thing on the side of, you know, of the device that you have in your hand, and you also see this slot on the side of the automaton, and you kind of look, and the automaton, in that slot, it almost looks like this just metal, almost like a two-pronged thing, and you just kind of, you pull it out, and you don't, it almost looks like it might be a key. And you can see that on this device it has slots that key could fit into, and so you kind of put them together, and then all of a sudden, and I'm assuming you guys are all kind of standing together, all of a sudden this device sort of lights up, and you can feel, the nanos can feel the nanites in the air just like going crazy, and for a minute everything feels light. Everything feels like weightless. And you realize that, in fact, what's happening is you're ascending up towards the pyramid slowly, not dangerously.
So Ogden, Ogden stands there, stiff as a board, his hands crossed, and nods his head and ascends.
Nice.
not being able to see his shut eyes behind his shades. Ken is floating up, and you know, he started to giggle and as he felt the nanites flow through his body and tangle away. And he throws his hands, splays them out, almost like he's lying down on the most comfortable, cushiony bed with pillows, and remembers that day where he was surrounded by the women fawning over him, and as he's floating up in this air, reliving this moment, you just hear him, oh, yeah. What?
His nuclear's floating up. He, what the fuck? What's going on? And he starts running like he did when he was charging towards those goat men, but he's in the middle of the air and he's not going anywhere, so he's just running and he's suspended as he's riding. What the fuck?
Awesome. And so as you kind of make it up to the top, Og sees again this almost like a panel up at the top and realizes that it's got these two slots in it. And almost as if he was like, you know, holding his sword aloft, but he's holding this, you know, this device. And slowly he goes up and it clicks in and he spins it. And you hear this woo, zzz, and then you see like these doors, you know, this metal door in the floor just go, you know, and they go to either side and you kind of ascend up into this black hallway. And as you kind of get up there and everybody's up and then they close below your feet, you're now standing in this basically it's a cube, it's this chamber about 50 feet to, you know, on either side, filled with all this Numenera. You see these panels with all these buttons on them, and you see these what look like glass screens with images. There's light behind them. This whole thing is just lit up, like something's going on here, like something's been activated. And you also see that, you know, all these banks of machinery only hold your attention for a minute, because you actually see on the ceiling these like metallic tentacle things hanging, waving around almost maniacally. And as you kind of look down further into the chamber, whoops, clicked the wrong thing here. You notice, and I'm going to see if I can pull this up, this scene. So you see these three people. You see these tentacles flying around. You see this one man. He looks paranoid. He's surprised at your presence here. And you see this man behind him with this, what almost looks like a sword, but maybe made out of light. And then this woman looking none too pleased that you're here. And this man kind of looks at you, and he says, "Who are you? What are you doing here? You're trying to steal my stuff, aren't you?"
"You and your stuff, I care nothing about." And Nog takes a step forward. "What I want is the goddamn rukomols." And he pulls out his knife 17 inches. He kind of pulls his back over like Hulk Hogan flexing. Stands up straight. "Where are the goddamn rukomols?"
And he looks... this mixture of confusion and anger kind of go over his face. He's like, "What the fuck are you talking about? What's a rukomol?" But then he sees that, you know, he sees the metallic arms on Nuclear, and he looks to his companions and he says, "You know, maybe that one's got the components we need. What do you think? These guys don't look too tough." But he waits, he hesitates to see what you guys are going to do.
"I'm going to split your fucking head to your teeth if you don't get out of my way." What do you guys do?
Almost to punctuate as he's saying that, knowing shit is about to indeed go down, as he's saying that, Ken, with both hands, just reaches slowly to his shades, grabs them, starts pulling them off slowly, and then rips them off quick.
Nuclear looks at Ken as he pulls his glasses off and eyeballs this dude, and he looks at him with his broken eye and his live eye, and he says, "What the fuck do you think you're talking to, sucker?"
Nice. And if Ken were to have spoken, you would see that his lips move a lot more than the actual words that are coming out of his mouth, but Nuclear does not. And they look to you, and you see the woman back there with her sword. She kind of looks to the main guy, and they just kind of nod. And then he kind of nods his head, as in, you know, gives us sort of like, all right, go get him kind of move. And why doesn't everyone go ahead and roll a speed test?
Og pulls out his shield. It's the shape of an octagon. It's red. On the surface, it says stop. He pulls it in front of him.
Nice.
And I got an 18 on my speed test.
Awesome. And Og, your shield is octagonal shaped, right?
That's correct, yes.
Okay, thought so.
I also got an 18 on my speed test.
Awesome.
Oh, just to let you know, my shield, it allows me to drop the speed test by one.
Okay.
That's how it functions in Numenera.
Awesome.
As his shield pops out and it says, stop, Nuclear starts laughing hysterically. And I got a 14.
Awesome. All right, so Ogden and Ken, you guys can, since you got the highest, you guys can decide which one of you wants to act first.
So what are these? It's a woman and a guy that are approaching us.
Yeah, so, well, so the woman is starting to approach. She's pulled out this big sword, probably the same size as yours. And she looks like she's just ready to mix it up. The guy in the back with that kind of lit up sword, he's just standing there kind of looking at this leader guy like, what do I do?
All right, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to dunk that knife into this black liquid that's sloshing around at my waist. I pull it back out. It's like Carnage, right, from Spider-Man, that kind of black dripping nastiness. I stick out my tongue, and I'm just going to stab her in the neck and watch her blood geyser up into the ceiling. And that's what, that's what I'm going to do.
So, normally, she would be a level 3, but because you got these tentacles flying around all over the place, it actually increases the difficulty by 1 because these things are flinging around. You could actually, they're trying to grab you, basically.
So, all right, I see what's up. Well, the knife is going to reduce it by 1 because it's a light weapon, and I'm going to spend a level of effort on my might to drop it down another. So for 2, for a number of 6 to try and hit her.
Yep.
Okay.
Sounds good.
I rolled a 9 on the die, so that'll be 8 points of damage, poison in her throat.
Wow. So, as you stab right into her throat and you see the poison kind of ripple through her veins, so is it 8, it's just 8 points of poison and then also the normal weapon damage, is that right?
Oh no, it's 6 points of poison and then 2 of weapon damage.
Okay, gotcha. Alright, so then in that case, yep. In that case, you severely damage her. She goes to one knee. She's not dead, but she's basically out of the fight. She can't seem to do anything. Yeah.
What I do is I wrap my hand around her hair. I pull her up like she's dangling, and I say, "Submit now or the bitch dies."
Nice.
All right, go ahead. Sorry, guys.
Yeah, again, just to point, you know, to put that punctuation mark on whatever this crazed individual that I ended up traveling with is saying, Ken is with his hands emptied, only the glasses in his hand. He puts it in his pocket. And he starts stretching and loosening himself up, starts hopping, punching the air, you know, warming up in front of everything, cracking his knuckles. And it's like each time he cracks his knuckles, you can see his hands start to pulse with a reddish energy. And he starts going faster and faster. His hands seem to echo their previous location more and more until he's standing there and he's like, "Aah!" And the red light around his hand forms claws as he's going to use the esoteric sculpt flesh to give himself claws.
Awesome.
Cool. All right. And so when you're using the esoteric, do you have to make any kind of roll for that, or you can just do it?
I spend the required intellect, which is 2 minus my intellect edge, spending only 1 intellect, and it lasts for the next 10 minutes.
Awesome. All right, fantastic. Now, as this happens, as this, you start to manipulate, the nanoparticles around you, and you form these claws on your body, you see the guy who was the leader, the one who was speaking, he steps forward, and he holds up his hand, and just as in the image, you see this light kind of blast out at you, especially at, not at you, Ken, but actually at Ogden, who just, felled one of the foes, and he's going to attempt to blast you with this energy. So he's a level 5, so I'm going to need you to go ahead and make a speed roll for me. Normally, it's
going to because I have the shield, it'll drop it by 1, which will make it 4, so the target number is a 12.
Except that there is still those tentacles flying around, which does increase the difficulty, so it would pop it back up to 5.
Oh, my God. Okay.
Yep.
At that point, I'm going to go ahead. Oh, no, I've already spent effort for my turn. All right. God, I'm about to get fucking hit. Mm-hmm. All right. 8. I take it.
Oh, snap. All right. So what happens... Oh, you're lucky. Okay. So, yeah, he blasts you with this just... this sort of kinetic energy, 5 points of damage as you, ignoring armor, as you sort of get rocked back by this blast from his hand, and he says, "You come to steal my stuff, this is what you get." But now Nuclear gets to go.
So you see Ogden, his chest smoking. He moves onto his elbows and lifts himself up, coughing up blood. Nuclear, get him!
Oh, man. I want to shove him.
Chris, are you
there? Can you hear me? Yo.
Yep.
Alright, I want to use one of my Azotaries. Onslaught.
Okay. Chris, I don't know if you were still talking or not. I can't hear you, though.
The last thing we heard was you wanted to use one of your esoteric's onslaught.
Yeah, I'm trying to find it.
Oh, okay.
Onslaught, if memory serves correctly, should cost 1 intellect. And upon taking onslaught, you have to decide whether it's a physical attack or a mental attack. If it's a physical, it does 4 damage, which is mitigated by armor, or 2 damage, which is not mitigated by armor, and... the 2 damage goes directly to the intellect pool.
I'm a motherfucking homeboy. Yeah, I would go with the physical attack.
Alrighty. So he's a level 5, so you'll need a 15 unless you want to spend some effort.
Yes, I'll spend my effort at this moment. Seeing my compadre all fucked up.
Alright, nice. So that'll reduce it, Actually, no. Yeah, so actually, no, I forgot, though, because you got those things flying around. So if you want, you guys do have the ability to try to sort of avoid the metal arms completely, but to do so is a level 3 speed test. And you can get pretty fucked up if you fail it. Otherwise, he would normally be a level 6, but if you spend effort, it brings it down to 5. So basically, you're probably better off spending your effort anyway, but you're still going to have to hit a 15.
Yeah, since I said I'd spend it, I'm going to go ahead and spend it.
Okay.
And I will roll.
Perfect.
I got a 14.
Ooh, so that just misses. What were you... You were trying to blast him with an onslaught, you said?
Yeah, with a physical one. So my arm reaches back, the mechanical one, and I swing this deadly blow towards him, and he just steps to the side out of the way. And nice. I look towards my companions like, ah, what are we going to do?
Nice. And you see as he does that, he kind of looks over to his companion, the one with this, what looks like a sword, with this light coming out of it, and he says, Derek, get him. And the guy doesn't say anything, he just kind of nods, and as he gets closer, and Nuclear, he's coming for you, he doesn't say anything, he just runs up, and you can see that this is actually like a stiff metal wire that produces this sort of aura of like energy around it, and he's going to attempt to attack you, so go ahead and make a defense roll, and you're going to have to, oh shit, you're going to, without, yeah, you're going to have to hit 15 is the target.
I got a 19.
Nice. All right.
Oh, so, my God.
Yeah.
So go ahead and decide. Go ahead and tell me what that looks like, how you either dodge or deflect his blow.
So as I look towards my companions and say, what are we going to do? He rushes towards me and his hand tentacle lashes out towards me. And my broken eye blinks to life for a brief second and catches it and gives me the upper hand. And I just drop to my knees and it goes over my head.
Awesome. Yeah, and these things are flying around, you know, kind of just almost wildly, not trying to attack anybody, but just flinging around. And you see that the woman is still kind of on her knees, not able to do anything with this blade at her throat. And with that, Ogden, what are you going to do?
Ogden stands there, the smoke sizzling off his chest. He drops the knife down to his side. It goes in his sheath. He pulls out the blade. And he approaches the man with a fucking blaster to cut him in two.
Nice.
Now, I think in Numenera, you are just able to make a movement, and then mm-hmm. the next time I'll be able to attack him, right?
Well, because you're in, he's kind of moved in, everything is within, oh no, that's true, yeah, he would be within a short range, so you're right.
Yeah, so I'll just move to him.
Okay. Absolutely. All right, Ken, cool. You are up.
Seeing this compatriot of mine screaming, what are we going to do, and then just being assaulted, assailed, and not necessarily knowing if he can defend himself adequately as this madman Ogden can do so with such ease, Ken jumps onto the back of the guy with the lit up sword and is just trying to tear flesh from bone.
Awesome.
And it's a 5 with the tentacles or
no, so the leader is normally a 5. So with the tentacles it would be a 6.
Well, not the leader, the guy with the lit up blade that was attacking.
Oh, then yes, that would be a 5 with the tentacles.
I'm going to try to do this without expending effort.
Okay.
Okay, so I can expend effort now, because I got a 16. I can expend effort now to add to the damage, right?
Yes, I believe you can.
Okay, so I'm going to actually expend the effort for the might now and add to this damage, and that deals additional 3 damage, correct? Because I can't quite remember.
I believe so, yeah.
All right, so I deal 9 damage as I'm just tearing apart at his back.
All right. So, yeah, you just rip apart on his back, and he yells out, "Rah!" And you can feel it. You kind of tear through this sort of leather armor. So he you know, takes some, and his blood is just kind of trickling down his back. And he's definitely angry at this point, but he is not dead. And again, seeing this this scene and seeing what you know, what's going on, seeing his companions being hurt, the leader is gonna go ahead and fire another blast. This time though, he's gonna go for Ken. So Ken, go ahead and make a speed defense roll for me. Normally, again, it's a difficulty 6, but.
Yeah, I got 18. I'm sorry.
Nice. Yeah. So he fires this blast of energy at you. And I don't know, you manage to sort of duck out of the way, and it kind of hits one of the panels behind you, and you see it kind of where it was all lit up and vibrant. Now it goes dark and kind of smashes the screen. You know, it doesn't take out the whole thing, but just this part of the panel. So, and you're also the unfortunate recipient of the man that you just tore up his back, so you get to make another defense roll against, again, a difficulty 5.
Nah, I only got a 7 that time.
Oh, ouch. So he would normally deal 6 points of damage as this blade cuts into you, but you have an armor of 3, is that right? So you only take 3. And you can feel the sort of extra white hot, you know, like heat, as this wire with this electrical current going through it just slices into your flesh. He kind of yells, and you know, but he also, you can see his movements are difficult. He's having a hard time here. He got a really lucky shot on that one. And Ogden, you are up. The woman's not taking any actions.
Ogden now next to the old man with the blaster.
Wait, isn't
he
it...
He takes the last of his poison, shatters it against his giant sword. Oh, I'm sorry, Chris. Go ahead.
Yeah, you're right. I'm sorry. It is Chris's turn. Yep, my apologies.
Nuclear takes the scene in front of him, knowing that he's not good at fighting physically, though sometimes his mechanical arm strikes a lucky blow, he begins to think what could benefit him the most, and he chuckles. And then his eye becomes, it lights up through the broken, and it begins to look throughout the Numenera shining in the room. And I want to make a skill check to see if I can use any of this Numenera against him, or to my benefit in any type of way whatsoever, to anybody's benefit.
Yeah, absolutely. You'll make an intellect roll, and you're going to need a difficulty. So it's a difficulty level 3.
I got a 7.
Okay. So you don't... You're kind of looking at these panels, looking at everything, trying to figure out if there's a way that you can sort of either control any of this stuff, and you just, with the confusion of battle and everything, you can't quite figure out a way to make that work. And so...
So, now beside me, this green glass sphere rises up behind my head. and it starts whistling. As I become saddened, and I look back at this fucking thing, and I'm tired of it describing my emotions to the world. And, nice. I look at the man, and I feel the tingle in my arm, and I look down at my mechanical hand, and it raises up, and my fingers on it meld together, forming a knife, and I scream out, and I start charging towards him. I got a 16.
So I think that the skill test to see if you could figure out how to use the Numenera would have been your action. But what I'll say is you can definitely start charging at him, and the next turn you'll be able to take another action.
Okay, sweet. Yeah, so I look around and I see the Numenera, and I'm like, fuck! The one tool that I always use to my benefit has forsaken me, this motherfucker. And my fingers meld together to form a knife, and I start charging gorilla-like towards this man.
Awesome. All right, and now, Ogden, it's your turn.
Ogden takes the last of his poison. He smashes it against his great sword, the glass and the black ooze running down. It's splashing at his feet. This is black eidocaine, liquid straight to the blood. I'm going to chop your fucking arm off. So, yeah, that's what I'm going to do. I'm gonna cut this guy a new one.
Go for it.
Da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da-da. 17!
Oh, yeah. Nice. So not only do you hit, you deal one extra point of damage.
Oh, yes. So that'll be 13 points of damage.
Wow. Damn. He is almost dead. You have, like, seriously injured him. In fact, I would imagine you actually slice off the arm that had been firing this, you know, this energy bolt at you. But you can describe more than that if you want, or how that looks.
All right. And so his hand comes out, and he's pleading. No! And you see the sword just split his hand to his elbow, and the arm just peels like a banana peel. The man falls down to one knee, and the arm's flapping around like tentacles.
Awesome. Yeah, and so, you know, he's now definitely hurt. Ken, you see this. You see this whole scene unfold in front of you, and what do you do?
Ken, just being knocked back by this energy blade, his clothing burned away. You can still see the little bit of embers as it continues to burn, the smoke coming from his singed flesh. Ken, in an attempt to accentuate the gravity of the situation of these guys that aren't fighting, he's just going to stand up and look the guy with the light blade that had just slashed him in the eyes, turn over to his shoulder to look at this gruesome event that is unfolding with this individual's boss or leader, and look back at the guy with a smug grin, with as smug a grin as he could muster, raise one of his clawed fingers, and then just wiggle it. Wiggle. And I'm keeping my eyes on this guy. Just in case, Ken is not going to attack, but if the guy does press the attack, I'll hop out of the way.
Okay. And he will try to press the attack. Now, this guy you can hear him muttering that this is the leader, the guy who had his arm, you know, severed, split like a banana. You can hear him muttering, you know, between his moans and his screams and, you know, the blood running down his body. He's like, they're going to take my stuff. I got to stop them. I can't let them take it. and he again attempts to blast you with this energy. Now, in this case, he's really hurting, so I would say that in this case, you can go ahead and make your speed defense, but it's going to be against a 4 instead of a 5. Ken.
Okay, this is the leader blasting me, or is this the blade guy?
No, it's the leader blasting you. He's trying to get you, yeah.
So would this be made easier because I'm waiting for an attack, or?
No, it's because he's so injured at this point, and he's, you know, he can barely function, so he's having a hard time.
All right.
I think since Ken spent his turn like waiting for attack, I think you get an advantage.
Do you? Okay.
I think so.
Okay. Yeah, that would make sense. So yeah, so then in that case, knock it down to a 3.
All right. Am I gonna expend effort? Yes, I'm gonna expend effort. No. Wait, no. From a 3 to a 2 is a 6, right?
6, yep.
So yeah, I get it. I got an 8.
Okay, fantastic. So,
oh, God.
Yeah.
I thought you were dead.
Yeah.
You started talking about 2s and 3s. So I was like, oh, fuck.
Yeah. Nice.
So Ken sort of is waiting for the attack, staring into the eyes of his opponent, all the chaos going on. But as Ken is looking into the eyes of his opponent, almost trying to look into his soul and crush him from within, he can see this injured boss and the light forming in the boss's other hand, gleaming the eyes of his minion. Seeing this unfold, Ken knows and he calculates the trajectory of this beam and almost failing, getting just enough out of the way that it singes pieces of his hair as he tilts his head slightly to the left. And it
I'm sorry, man, but you needed actually to roll a 9 because it was a level 3.
No! So it singes his ear and he gets fucked up and his head comes off.
Oh, man. That's brutal. Yeah, so then in that case...
I thought it was a 2, that's why. Because he said it dropped to a 4, right?
Oh, originally a 4.
Because I expended
and then...
But you use your effort.
Yeah,
but...
Oh!
Oh, no. Yeah, no, I think you're right, Ray, because you used the effort and you readied the action. So readying the action...
Awesome, my bad.
Why are you trying to kill me?
Sorry.
Why are you trying to kill me? Motherfucker!
It's like, wait, no! So you did use that time dilation right there. You were like, oh, God, I thought I'm... Wait, no, I'm good. With that, Nuclear, you're up.
Whew. So, seeing it cut his hair, Nuclear, at this point, charging the little bit of distance that he had between him and this man, sees the blood from his shredded arm, and leans back. He puts his knife into the ground, and he slides across it, screaming, "Ah!" He sees his friend dive back, that beam cutting his hair. He slides in and he swings this knife. He karate chop this motherfucker in the throat.
Oh, yeah. So, again, I'm going to say that it's a 4 because he's so, you know, he's so injured at this point.
I got a 9.
Yeah, so that is not successful. Yep.
So as my blade drags across the ground underneath the spray of blood, it's causing sparks from the stone floor. I drag it up and swing it across his throat to bring it across his throat, and the blood hits my eyes, and I scream, "Ah!" And it just misses over top of his head, shaving hair.
Nice. And... The guy with the light blade there, he's sort of looking to the leader, not sure quite what to do. He's actually hesitating because he's so injured, and he actually just kind of waits. you see that the woman, she's still alive, but at this point she's basically no longer on her knees. She's just kind of on the ground, just sort of, you know, kind of huddling, like, I don't want to die here. And so, you know, you see the leader look over to the guy with the blade and he's like, Derek, what are you doing? Attack, you coward, attack them. And he looks and he just, you know, you see this fear in his eye, like he doesn't want to do it. He doesn't want to be here. You know, he's not this kind of guy, and so he doesn't. He disobeys. And so with that, it's actually Ogden. It goes back to you.
Ogden, in front of this crippled man, his arms split in twain, walks over to his side, his sword at his chest. Just try to feel good. Do what makes you feel good. Do what feels good to you. And I go down to his ear and collect those moments. And I'm going to sever his head. Since he is disadvantaged, I would say, yeah, I drop it down to a 3.
Yep.
Boom! 19!
Ooh. Oh, yeah. So, 19 obviously will allow you to either add, I believe, 3 points of damage, which is enough to kill him, or a minor effect.
All right, but yeah, so you're gonna here's what I'm going to do. I'm going to sever his head, and as it goes spinning up in the air, the other two are going to surrender.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah, that happens. I mean, they really don't have any, you know, any recourse at this point, and their boss is dead. So, yeah, and so as the head goes spinning up in the air, what do you do?
I cut off the head, and I stand there. I look down at the blood. I put my 3 fingers into it. I pull it up and I smear it over the cross of my face. Do you want a taste, or are you going to give up now? That's what I do. That's my intimidation.
Nice. Sorry, my computer was not letting me unmute. You intimidated the computer. So, yeah, that's awesome. And they definitely are, like, cowering. In fact, the guy with the light blade runs. He just starts running out this back door. And the woman is just laying there, just kind of shaking her head, saying, don't kill me. Don't kill me. And she starts trying to crawl away.
No one's going to kill you. Submit. And as I reach down and take the old man's blaster.
Oh, he didn't actually have a blaster. He was actually just shooting energy out of his hand.
Oh, motherfucker!
Yeah.
Alright, so I just take out my knife and I start cutting off his armor, if he has any armor, and I start just taking his shit.
Yeah, see where absolutely. You are, I tell you to run away.
Nice. And yeah, you know that he's got 4 ciphers on him. I'll go ahead and at the end and let you know what they are. Because there's no more danger.
I'll write that down.
Yeah, but yeah, you found 4 ciphers on him. This guy was a nano that was a little bit nuts. and he does have armor. At this point, his armor. I would imagine if you want to, you could use it. It's a level 2 armor, but I guess just a 2 armor, not really a level 2 armor, but yeah.
Oh, it's a medium armor?
Yeah, medium armor. There you go. Thank you. So as you look around, these tentacles are still kind of flipping around, flinging around in here, but you see that the panels are still humming. Everything is the same as it was before. There's just no human threat here anymore. You don't currently see any of the rukomol, but you now know that there is another door off of this room because that guy, you know, the guy with the light blade went out of it, so.
All right, I walk over to the woman.
Speaking of the guy with the...
Oh, sorry, go ahead, Nelson.
No. Speaking about the guy with the light blade, Ken tries to react and chase him down as he's running away, and after taking his first 3 steps, Ken... falls to the ground on one knee, grabs his chest, and you can see him trying to choke back as he's coughing up a bit of blood, and he's going to take an action to take a recovery.
Okay. Yep.
Ogden walks over to the woman. He wrenches her hair. He brings her up. He looks her in the face. What is this place? What do you know of it? And tell me, woman. And I shake her head like a Yahtzee dice.
Nice. And she says, I only know what Gile told me. He was looking for something to, you know, to repair his Numenera. To repair his ciphers. And so now you know that the ciphers that you have seem to be broken. But he says, so he figured out that this place could create that mist, and that mist would bring biomechanical things here. Hopefully things that would help him find the parts he need to fix his Numenera. But he hasn't found anything. It didn't seem to work, or at least he didn't tell me if it worked. And she's like, beyond that, I don't know. I mean, we haven't explored this place. It's huge.
I look over to Nuclear. Nuclear, what's that leg telling you?
I look down at the leg, and I use my Numenera on it to see if I can draw any information from it.
All right, sure. So I would say that that could be an asset for you. So normally, so go ahead. This would be a level. Normally, it's a level 6 device. So I'll say that the asset will make it down to a level 5. And then if you want to spend some effort, you can. You mean like the main kind of panel, right? That you're looking at, kind of the main device, figuring out what this place does?
Yeah.
Okay, yeah.
They only had 1 point of effort, and I spent it.
Well...
Oh, you can keep spending it.
Yeah, you can keep spending it, because you're not in combat anymore, so you can just... Yeah.
Oh, well, fuck, yeah.
Effort is only limited by a round-by-round basis.
It
the
is.
1 point of effort is how much you can spend within that round.
Alright. Motherfucker. So I will, definitely spend it. And with that, an 18.
Oh, yeah. So you basically, you start kind of fiddling with the screen, and you see these sort of images come across the screen, and you're kind of putting it together. You realize that this is some sort of control panel, that this whole panel, this whole sort of chamber that you're in might be the central control panel. And you kind of put the pieces together, and you click this one image, and all of a sudden these tentacles start turning off. They just, and they stop moving. So there's no more danger from that. Also, these lights start to come on brighter where it was dark before, or a little bit darker before. You know, it's now activated these lights, and you can you see this one image that looks like this sort of blue wavy lines, and you would imagine that would be that blue mist that the woman was talking about, the blue mist that you guys witnessed. So this device can create this mist. And you also see one, this image that looks like doors and whatever, and when you click on it, you hear vzzz, and it opens this door, you know, kind of in the back. And you can hear these sounds coming from that back door. This
So yeah, it's, Nuclear is there, finally. This is his thing. This is what he does. He explores. He likes fucking with stuff like this, the Numenera. He's pressing these buttons, figuring it out, and the arms like, and then they start making a wave. Like robots. And he giggles under his breath as they do this, and they high-five each other. And he looks over at him. This controls many, many things, he says as he looks around, playing with the tentacles, and the door opens and shuts. And then he looks around, because honestly, to him, this is more important to his allies at this point. He looks around for something that could fix his broken eye. Anything he could cut out or use. I would say he has a small bag of tools. Maybe he has like a Dremel tool.
Isn't there a part of this pyramid that fixes ciphers? Maybe that could do something.
Yeah, and so, well, so you actually, Phil, one of the things that you found on Giles' body was this sort of tool kit, and he actually had these broken Numenera. He was looking for components to fix them, and what you guys start to put together was what this did, this mist, actually brought the rukomol. Theoretically, the rukomol could, they are biomechanical, so they could potentially be used to fix his ciphers. So that's what happened there. So
did the mist eat them?
No. Well, as far as you know, no. I mean, you guys hear strange noises coming from the other room. You can assume that they are in that adjacent room to this chamber. And in fact, one of the things that happens is you kind of see this panel, and on the panel you see this button, and when you click it, nuclear, the wall, which was currently black, now goes like opaque, and then you can actually see it's like a two-way mirror kind of into the other room, and you can see the seven, well, six and a half rukomol because one's missing a leg, but yeah, you can see them in there, and they look skittish. They don't look happy, and it's just this kind of empty chamber. There's not really much in there. Looks like it might have been a storage chamber.
Dude, press the button. Just press it.
Yeah,
I have a device with a button. I press it.
Yeah. You guys all...
I pick up the woman. She feels here. Like a soft sack of potatoes. I put them over my shoulder.
Nice. Yeah, and so you know you can go into that other room if you need to. You know, and so I assume, are you guys going to... At this point... if you want to, you can explore a little bit, but you also realize that, you know, you've basically completed what you've come here to do. Now all you got to do is figure out how to get these rukomol out of this pyramid and back to...
I got the woman. Back to Codun. I smack her on the ass. How the hell do we get out of here?
And she says, same way you came up, I imagine. How'd you get up here?
I am the wrong person to ask that. There was a robot down there on the tower. I put some kind of key in it. We started floating.
Nice. No, you actually took the key from the robot. You put it into that cipher.
And then at the end you pulled
it out of the cipher and popped it up into the little key lock in the pyramid. So... yeah, so you or potentially one of your companions could see if that cipher still works.
Yep.
You know, it's like, Ken, here, check it out.
Ken looks at the device. He's like, is he going to explode?
Yep. But yeah, if one of the nanos were to look at it, this actually is not an ordinary cipher. Yeah. This is an artifact, so this continues to work.
Oh, that device is an artifact. Holy cow.
Yeah.
Nice. So yeah, Ken would have looked at it and I guess found out that it's an artifact, and he's like, ooh.
Yep.
And fiddles around with it and sees if it still works. I'm gonna see if this still works, and you can toss her down to see if she lands all right. As he tries to say under his breath.
Oh, so you're going to sort of open the hatch that you came
open
up
open the and, hatch yeah. and you know, do what seems to be needed to be done. And under his breath, mention to his brand new and bestest and one of his only friends, whom he lovingly calls Ford, to toss that bitch down the hole to see if she floats down or just falls to her death.
I bring her over, and it's like a scene from a movie where the villain is holding Gwen Stacy, and Spider-Man has to make a decision between the car and the woman. And, like Green Goblin, he just drops her.
Nice. And so... He sees the woman dropping. It reminds him of his father falling. Oh my god. And so
does the Numenera thing kick in, or does he pop?
Yeah, so no, it does. So if you okay. pop the key into the Numenera device, and it does, it creates this sort of anti-gravity field. And so where she's starting to fall, she's like, ah, and then all of a sudden it sort of slows, and she doesn't come back up. She actually does still descend, but she descends very slowly. And you can kind of see these nanoparticles just kind of spinning almost in like a vortex, you know, kind of showing this like tunnel going down, and it's connecting to the you know, that automaton that was on the thing. So it connects these two sort of electrical devices together and creates this.
I turn to Ogden. Holy shit, it works!
Ogden jumps down like he's a Greg Louganis diving in the Olympics.
Nice. Yep, you do. And for just like a split second, you fall full speed, but then you slow, and you know you just kind of down to the top of the tower.
What about the rooks?
Nuclear jumps off and begins running in the air again, screaming.
Guys, the rocks!
Oh, do you want to check stuff out there?
Well, at the very least, you should probably get the rukomol, yeah.
We didn't get the rukomols, dude.
Well, yeah, I left that to you.
Oh, God.
You gotta push them down here.
So, yeah, I'm like, here, buggy, but come on. Well,
and remember, you have that, you have that sort of device that Yola's giving you.
Oh yeah, I pressed that a little while ago.
Yeah.
Yep.
But it's Ogden that has the device.
Okay. Well, I imagine Ogden would still remember it at some point. He's like, and he pushes it, and you kind of see the rukomol, like their heads kind of pop up, and they like start skittering, you know, through the hallway, and they come into the room where you are. And at this point, he's now gone, so that device is out of their range, and they're sort of like looking around, and they're just sort of waiting there, not sure what to do, and they're starting.
Can I like edge them along? Come on, like edge the first one close enough to the hole in the floor to see if he can start receiving the signal, or just fall and float down.
Well, so considering that this thing is a 14-foot biomechanical creature, yeah,
I'm not edging anything on. I'm like,
yeah. I mean, you would probably have to use it. They're not like completely automatons, though. They do have some sort of intelligence. So I mean, you can attempt to make an intellect test. It would be against a difficulty 3.
I'm just can I like turn this key in the other direction? And as Ogden is floating down and nuclear right behind him, can I turn it to reverse the field so he comes back up with the switch?
You're just fucking with nuclear at this point, aren't you?
Yeah, you can turn it, but I'm going to leave it up to those guys to tell me what happens or tell me what happens. So you reverse the field, essentially.
So I'm almost at the ground, fingertips an inch away. I see like the ground starting to get further and further away and being pulled back up.
No! No!
Yeah, Nuclear's the same way. He's like, like the gorilla panicking, and he sees his augment almost there and start descending back up, and then he starts descending back up himself, and it freaks him out even more. So let's go get these fucking rukomol.
Whenever he's close enough that the rukomol start going to the signal again, I won't even wait for him to get all the way up. As soon as they start going towards the signal, I'll just turn the switch again so it starts going back down.
Well, now, as Nuclear starts descending back up, he realizes that he never fixed his eye. So it's a good thing that he's going back up anyway. So he can take care of that.
Yo. So you actually think that there's the potential. Your eye wasn't damaged so terribly that it would require major repairs. So you figure that that rukomol leg that led you up here, you could probably use that. You don't know exactly how you'd have to do it, but it is a biomechanical device that might be able to aid in repairing your eye. But you would need some time and some tools and equipment to do it. But yeah, at this point, the rukomol are starting to get agitated. They're, having this Numenera and having these screaming people, coming in and out. They don't know what's going on. So. What do you guys want to do?
So I get back
up. Are they jumping down the hole yet?
I'm unfortunately stuck between a rock and a hard place, caught in a gravity device. So I'm pretty much at the whims of Kin. So
nice.
I would say.
Although I've moved into a position like a lotus, and I'm just like floating in the air like I'm Buddha.
Yep.
You think I'm able to get back up to him by this point?
Yeah.
Yeah, so as I rise back up to him, running, I jump back in. Let's get these rukomol. My bad.
Nice. And so, potentially, you would either have to shove them, which might be difficult to do, or you could try to sort of coax them and say, come on, down into the hole. If you try to coax them in, it would just be a difficulty 3. Intellect roll. So
don't they start jumping down the hole when they get within range of that button thing again?
Well, I don't know. Did he push it?
Yeah, I pushed the button. I pushed I was still in the station.
Yeah.
Unless okay. It turns off.
Yeah, well, it would. I mean, you'd have to push it, but that's fine. Yeah, you push it, so then they start going choo-choo-choo down, and you guys all sort of, now descend at this point. Ogden in lotus position.
Mm-hmm.
And then the rukomol behind it.
That's kind of an amazing image.
Yeah. Are you holding your sword aloft in front of you, kind of,
Oh, the sword's just, like, floating in front of me.
Nice.
So so it's like, first the chick goes down. Ah, whoop. Yeah. And then Ogden. Yeah. Whoop. And then, Nuclear. Ah, whoop. And then everybody's waiting for these damn, I'm the only one screaming up at the top, what about the rukomol? You know what? Fuck it. So the gravity field comes up, Nuclear is like, whoop. Yeah, my bad about the rukomol. And then, Ogden starts getting close enough, and the rukomol start going, pew, 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 and the chick that was initially thrown, like right before she lands on the floor, she's like, ooh, I made it. I'm not dead. Oh, shit. And she starts coming up, and now she's going back down. And then in the lotus position with the floating sword right after her comes Ogden, and then a bunch of rukomol. And then Ken and Nuclear.
What are we going to do?
So I land. I grab my sword out of the air. The woman's laying there, her hair spread over by the android. She looks up. I smack her. What are you sitting around here for? get up. So Rukomol start landing. I told you to get up. Another smack.
Nice.
He grabs her by the wrist, yanks her. Blood still dripping out of her neck. You gonna make it?
I don't know.
I give her a sip of water. Come on. I look down at all these fucking Rukomol. There's three more to land.
Awesome. Yeah, and so you start descending the stairs with, you know, with the woman, you know, kind of smacking her and whatever, and she can't do anything. I mean, she's too injured at this point. So she just does it, and then, yeah, the Rukomol sort of are following you down these stairs, and they're actually surprisingly agile. They just on their six legs, you know, these huge creatures. And this tower is big enough that they can actually do it.
No, I put the woman on one of them.
Oh, okay. Yeah, that's
And then funny. I hop up behind her. I saddle her.
Nice.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, so the way they work is there's sort of like a saddle on the neck area where somebody would, like, steer them, and then there's one on the back where they would, like, you know, kind of whack them or something to get more speed, so, yeah, that's fine. And I assume the rest of you guys follow.
Hell yeah.
Nice.
Yeah, again, like, everything happening, transpiring, the anti-gravity yo-yo, the Rukomol, the slapping of this woman, don't know who she is, bleeding at the neck, the saddling, the crazy ape cyborg guy just going up and down the damn gravity shaft.
I make it to the end of the tower. I see the old woman. I point to the back of to the back of the Rukomol. There's a saddle back there. I motion for her to get on. I hear my mother's voice. Collect those moments.
And at the sight of the Rukomol, she actually freaks out and starts running. And she doesn't realize quite where she is, and she smacks face first into, you know, a building, and she actually is knocked unconscious, and you can see, you know, the rat that was in her hand kind of go flying out behind her.
There go the last bit of her teeth.
Yep.
I shrug my shoulders. We head off into the desert.
Awesome. Yeah, and you guys make it back to the city of Codun, and Uolis is so grateful as you return his Rukomol. He's like, you know, I can't thank you enough. This was my livelihood. Without it, everything would have been lost. And he's like, I've promised you, you'll be taken care of, and so you will. And he actually gives each of you a pouch full of shins. And he, you know, you get about 20 shins each, which is all right. But then he also hands you each two ciphers. He's like, I don't know what these are. You know, I've collected them. Part of them, they're my winnings. I haven't had a chance to check them out, but they mean nothing to me now. I wouldn't even have got them without these Rukomol. So here you go. So he hands you each these random ciphers, so you have two ciphers.
I have so many ciphers right now, it's ridiculous.
Yeah, you do. You have about six, I believe. Well, at least six new ones. So, yeah, you'll want to be careful.
I look over these guys. Hey. Hey, you cupcake. Hey, you Twinkie. Come over here. I give them each two ciphers.
Awesome.
I don't know if we can hang on to those ciphers. Do they start, like, sparks flying and everything?
They might. You could potentially have right now like two ciphers kind of active. I would say if you start to collect very many more, yeah, they're gonna start doing weird things.
Yeah. So, Chris, I don't know if you remember, you can only hold on to but so many ciphers at once before they start interacting.
Yeah, and
getting buggy. Yeah. I'm holding on. I didn't use any of my ciphers, so I'm holding on to seven right
Holy
now.
Shit.
So I'm like, Oh, plus the artifact key that I had that I was turning back and forth.
Where's my damn artifact, kid?
You just look at all the ciphers.
Kid, where's my damn artifact?
I can feel power resonating in my hands. It feels like fire burning. He's just stuck, muttering over and over to himself.
Nice. Ogman sounds like Beetlejuice.
So Ken's just standing there, artifact in one hand. He has taken these other ciphers in his other hand, and he's like, like, what do I do? Nice.
God damn it.
I could maybe take one of those off your hands if you like.
Chuckles under his breath, if you don't want to hold on to them.
I grab the woman. I have a chain around her neck now. I yank her down.
Bitch. Oh, man.
Don't look at me. Don't look me in the eye. Myself
long enough to hand Ogden one of my ciphers, and it happens to be a tube with the same writing as that Nuclear did when he tripped up all the Beastmen. here?
Hey, use that in a special moment. Nuclear is going to take it advantage, I guarantee you.
Oh, dear God. Yep. And so, awesome. So, yeah, so what I'm going to let you guys do at this point, you can each sort of do an exit scene if you want, kind of determine sort of how you want to end it. I'll start with Phil. If you want to go ahead, you can do that.
Oh, sure. No problem.
Thanks.
So, we're out in this little town. Is it Comden?
It's Codun.
Codun, yep. Yeah. We're in Codun. There's a tavern. There's beer is just frothing, splashing, just gushing everywhere. You see him in the back. The woman's on a chain underneath the table. He's drinking a beer. And it sloshes over, and you see some of the foam drip down between. It hits the woman on the face, and she's frowning. That's the end.
Nice. All right, Chris, if you want to go next.
As Ogman's doing that downstairs, Nuclear's upstairs in a room, bent over the leg of this animal with screwdrivers. He's chuckling to himself as he takes apart this leg and he grabs the pieces that he needs to fix his eye. Yes, he says, as he does.
Awesome. And
yeah, I guess while here. Downstairs, Ogden is just domineering over his brand new pet, and upstairs in one of the rooms, while Nuclear is fiddling around trying to repair his unfortunately damaged eye. In another room upstairs, you would see on one of these beds, splayed out, shirtless, the fresh scar, the burn mark of where he was slashed in the previous battle. Smoke filling the room, shades on his face, women all around him, just, oh, Ken, rubbing at the scar, and he grins, you're so tough.
Awesome. And so you guys do that, and you hang out for a little bit, you know, a few more days in the town, and you're kind of now famous, or maybe infamous in this town, I'm not sure which, but regardless, you're treated sort of like heroes. In fact, Uolis is so grateful that he's, you know, showing you around all his friends, and, you know, you guys watch a couple more races, and of course he's on fire. He's great. You know, he's doing his thing. He's happy. And you have the opportunity to you know, kind of check all these different ciphers and reflect on this ridiculous adventure that you just went on. And so with that, you guys, it's all, you know, sunshine and rainbows, and the scene fades to black. And so this, so anybody who watches this, this is the perfect example of how you can chuckle fuck your way through Numenera. I don't know about anybody else. I had fun. I thought it was hilarious. So, you know, I had a good time.
I had a great time.
Oh, yeah. I'm going to go ahead and end the broadcast, but I wanted to thank you guys all, and I look forward to doing some more Numenera.
Cool.